So this one, we actually looked at this fridge before. It's that dual evap unit that we did that whole, how much troubleshooting can you do in 30 minutes thing. I think we did that last week. So it came up again at a topic at appliantology. A tech noticed that the symptom was that the refrigerator compartment, which is what we're looking at here, this is the refrigerator evaporator, cooled down the lower part, but things on the upper part were getting warm and starting to spoil. And when he took off the cover, this is the frost pattern on the evaporator. So this guy did some really solid troubleshooting. First thing he did, he went into test mode and he started testing loads. Like he put the evaporator fan into a forced run mode and it did not run. And then while in that forced run mode, he went to P14 on the board and checked for the various inputs that he's supposed to get going to that evaporator fan. So you've got, it's a BLDC fan. So you've got your voltage supply, you've got your DC ground, and you've got a pulse width modulated signal. And so he checked for all of those coming out from the board, going to the fan, and they were all good. He was getting in spec on all of these. He was getting the 14 volts as the power supply to it. He was getting the signal that it was trying to full run the fan at full speed. So it was getting a full, I think this 14 volts is a little off. It's actually like 12.6 volts when it's running at full speed. But regardless, close enough. He got a 12.6 in that PWM line. So the board is trying to run the fan at full speed. That's what that means. If you've got a good DC voltage supply and you've got basically the same voltage as your DC voltage supply on that PWM line, that means the board is trying to get that fan to run.
And that's voltage between PWM and ground,
Correct. Yeah.
not between PWM and VCC.
Exactly. Yeah, good to point out. So after all this, I mean, you guys tell me if you've got a good voltage supply, ground, PWM right up to the evaporator fan and the fan's not running, what does that tell you?
That fan.
Fan's bad.
Yeah, and that is what the problem was. But why I'm pointing this out is that this guy did not have the confidence to just make that diagnosis. He was still
Right.
scratching his head a little bit and questioning himself.
So he's a newer tech and he's just still getting used to the process. And you know how they tell pilots when you're getting instrument rated, you got to trust your instruments. Same with us, with techs, we got to trust our instruments. We got to trust our voltage readings and we got to trust our troubleshooting process. So if you've got good inputs to something like a fan, and the fan's not working, your mental troubleshooting algorithm is slam dunk, bad fan motor, and you just got to trust it. And after, and it's, so it comes with experience. After he does this a couple more times, he'll see that, oh, that it really does work this way. The physical world really does work this way. And these appliances are totally logical machines, to the extent that the manufacturers choose to reveal the logic to us, and they will work consistently based on those principles. And you just have to trust your process and go with it.
And he could have, if he was unsure, he could have did another test. He could have did like a cheater test or something just for
Yeah.
extra measure, just to give
Hook
you,
it
if
up to
you're
a battery.
unsure, you're like,
Yeah,
yeah, more confidence.
9-volt battery. Yeah, you can say that a cheater is another way of doing that. It's another, but in this case, he didn't even need to cheater it because he had all good supply, all good inputs to that motor.
I think also that maybe him being new and the way it was written, if you were seeing that it's supposed to have 14 volts DC and you're only getting 12.6, if you're new and you don't understand exactly what's going on, you could possibly think maybe something's still not right. So I think it's a good point that Sam said there, that I think was closer to 12.6, is the 14's never accurate, but if you don't understand what's going on there, then that can throw you off too, and that may give a new technician hesitation.
That's a great point, Tim. That yeah, it takes experience to know when, a spec can
When
be slightly off and it doesn't mean anything.
or when you've got wiggle room on a spec and when you don't.
Exactly.
So is 14 volts DC a common? I'm usually thinking 5 or 12 or 10.
Yeah, it is a little odd. You see it a decent amount. But as you can see, it's not even really consistent. I think a lot of these that they're giving a nominal 14 DC for, they're actually more like, yeah, 12.6, 13 something. They're a little less than 14. So I'm not sure why they chose 14 to give in all these spec blocks. There are actually a number of errors throughout this spec block. I think I covered those in a previous dojo for this model.
And
It's close enough.
some of the assessment of how much when you have wiggle room and when you don't, you get with understanding the technology you're dealing with. So, for example, in this case with a BLDC fan motor, you knowing that you can hotwire, and if you actually do it, hotwire it with a 9-volt battery, well, you're only supplying 9 volts, and it still works. So you know what I mean? So some technologies are more forgiving than others, and motors are a little more forgiving than some other things.
Yeah, the low voltage DC loads in general, you can get away with a little variance because the voltage is so small. You know, 1 or 2 volts here doesn't make a big difference.
I find technicians are more, or I find the technicians are less understanding about DC and more hesitant to do DC tests than AC tests, which to me is weird. But that's what I find.
Yeah, it's a different way of thinking about it because you're dealing with different circuit mm-hmm. altogether, different supply, mm-hmm. different ground. But
they're afraid things are going to blow up. They don't want to.
Well, that's a nice thing about that's a nice thing about DC. Right. You can short it all day long, and no risk of letting out the magic smoke anywhere.
Yeah, it's funny. I was at a county fair yesterday, and I met a guy there who what he does now is he weaves chairs to display at this county fair. He makes like these old woven chairs. But up until 1996, the year I was born, he did appliance repair in the state of New Hampshire. So I had a fun conversation with him about that. And he's totally mystified. Like he was asking me about appliances nowadays. I was talking about, oh, they all have control boards, because he comes from the days when he has no idea what to do with a control board. He thinks that you have to be a computer technician to troubleshoot them. The only thing he knows how to do is timers.
Just inputs, outputs, and algorithms. Yeah. It's no different from anything else.
Yeah, I was trying to explain to him. You don't have to be a computer tech. You just have to know your troubleshooting principles.
Right.
How to approach it. There's a couple of other things that this guy, there's a helpful tidbit he actually pointed out in the topic. When he did get around to replacing that evaporator fan, if you go to the parts list, you see that there are actually two different part numbers it gives for, you've got the fan, and then you've got this evaporator insulation with fan assembly. And if you look at those two different parts, depending on where you're finding them, here is the evaporator fan motor, $104. Here's that whole assembly, which includes the evaporator fan, but also has all the insulation, $107. So just one of those cases where, yeah, if you see an assembly, you should at least take a look at it and see if its cost is pretty much the same as the part by itself.
Yeah, I generally go for assemblies. It's especially true with Samsung. If they offer an assembly, always do the assembly, the stuff in the dotted line. It makes the repair a lot easier. It's actually a better repair for the customer too, but it makes it a lot faster and easier repair.
Especially with dishwashers too, if it's like a sump and motor assembly, especially if there's water involved with connections.
Yep.
Yeah, I prefer that too.
Yep.
Yep. And in this case, it means you don't have to pull the evaporator fan out from that styrofoam and then slide the new one back in. You can just pop in and out the whole thing.
And it's a better repair for the customer. You're not ripping them off at all because they're actually getting more stuff there. And like in this case with the styrofoam, who knows how compromised that styrofoam is from moisture intrusion.
Mm-hmm. And that particular one gets cracked easily once it freezes up.
Okay.
That one right there, I've seen it gets beat up.
So yeah, assemblies, my bias is always go for the assembly unless the price difference is outrageous, then I reconsider and just evaluate and make sure it's still worth it.